Okay, I guess we're all set. This program will have a lot about community and family. Grange is two of the milestones of the Grange. And as just a brief background of the Grange, so we'll know what we're dealing with. The Grange was founded in 1867 in Washington, D.C. by seven people. And you see them right here in the Grange seal here. They go around. Al Hudson Kelly is the chief one. Then there's six other people who helped found the Grange. So you'll see their names, which is on the official Grange seal, which you see there. They were civil servants. They weren't really farmers. They were in the agriculture, however. And they were people who were interested in agriculture and in farming. But we're not really farmers as we think of them today. The Grange in 1867, due to the efforts of Caroline Hall, who was the niece of Oliver Hudson Kelly, became the first organization in American history, the major organization in American history, to admit women on an equal basis. So that was a really radical thing, because remember, we don't have women allowed to vote nationally until 1920. So it's interesting to see how far ahead the Grange was in its thinking, thanks to Caroline Hall. The Grange in Maine arrived in 1873 and would be here for the rest of the time of Maine's history. It would be it started off rather well and then had a decline briefly in about 1880, then came back as agricultural prosperity developed and it was possible to for farmers to make a living. The Grange in this period was, of course, the real contest between the so-called book farmers and the so-called dirt farmers. And remember, the dirt farmers were ones that had learned agriculture from their fathers or their forebears, and the book farmers were people interested in scientific agriculture. And the Grange, of course, began to encourage farmers to be interested in learning the latest techniques. And so, therefore, books and journals and magazines and newspapers were very important to farmers in this period. We also want to remember that Maine was very isolated, as much of the country was in this period. And for many people, the Grange was a beacon of light and hope for many people, because, particularly women, because it was a chance to get away from the drudgery of home. And, of course, women's work in the 19th century, particularly, was not really that different. Men's work tended to go by the seasons, but women's work was basically washing, cooking, preserving, all those things, raising children, all those things that you had to think about every day. And so the Grange was a real respite from this, and they had a chance to talk to other women, and it was really a wonderful opportunity for them to relieve the isolation they felt in these isolated Maine towns. The Grange, of course, was founded to help farmers through cooperatives, and many Granges had Grange stores. They also began to have their own insurances, insurance companies, and also had their own banks in some cases. And so those were the interests were, and railroads, of course, were the one of the interests were very oppressive to farmers. They charged exorbitant fees, and the Grange movement, of course, the National Grange movement, of course, occurred in the 1870s. There was an attempt to overcome some of the obstacles farmers felt. We also want to remember that by 1914, we had the Smith-Lever Act, which set up the Extension Service. And the Extension Service was a real glow in the dark for many rural people because it took over what the Grange was doing previously. The Grange had been the adult education movement of the rural America, and now the Extension Service was coming in and trying to show people the best techniques, both women and men, in the home and farm. We also remember that the Grange was a real pioneer in libraries. Many libraries were started by Granges, many libraries were in Grange halls in the 19th century and in the early 20th century. And I still go to Granges, which still have a Grange library. Isn't it interesting? There's one down at West Minot has, I think, has a Grange library. West Minot Grange still has a little Grange library there. We also want to remember that the Farm Bureau came in the World War I period, and of course, many of the meetings were held in Grange halls. And the 4-H Club comes with the Smith-Lever Act, of course, and that's another organization that was very much tied into Granges and farm families and communities, etc. So So let's go to our slides now and see what we can find. East Bethel has always been a rural community. I love this postcard. Greetings from East Bethel. It's anywhere USA, but has East Bethel name on the bottom, so you can see what. But it's not any place we know of in East Bethel. It's just a generic view. But I just want to put that in to sort of get you oriented to East Bethel. So that's. Let's go to the next one. Yeah. And we see here the home of Lincoln and Sue Fisk as it looked around the turn of the century. This supposedly is one of the oldest houses still standing in Bethel, and gives us an idea of how old East Bethel is in comparison to some other parts of the town. And of course, Bethel, as I mentioned, have three Granges, one at Bethel Hill, one at West Bethel, and one at East Bethel. The East Bethel Grange, of course, would not be started in the town, but would eventually end up here. And Bethel Grange was number 56 and was a fairly early grange. We can tell by the numbers of the grange when they were founded. And it was founded Bethel Hill. And then the West Bethel Grange, Pleasant Valley Grange is known as, was founded in the 1870s, as was Bethel Hill Grange, or Bethel Grange number 56. Alder was started in the 1870s, but it died about 1880s. We don't know why. And we find the last meeting was really held in 1893. We find it the last mention of any kind of gathering. And it wasn't until 1904 that it was reorganized. The reason it's called Alder River is that it was organized at in Locke's Mills at the hotel, which is across from what used to be Bob's Plumber Store, which is now a Round Pond Store. And of course, it was organized by East Bethel people, so it would be logical that eventually it ended up in East Bethel. Of course, the very next year, they do build the hall at East Bethel, 1905. And so they started with 1904, having been something to do with homes, and they raised enough money to build the hall. So we'll get into that a bit more. Okay, let's go to the next slide. Here's a good view of Innervale of East Bethel. I think we're looking, this is Hannah looking into East Bethel. But you can see this wonderful farmland, which made it possible to be very successful in East Bethel, many farms, and almost everybody had a farm. Even way in the 1950s, when I was growing up there, almost every place with a farm or had some kind of farm operation, either had a cow or sheep or something. And so it gives you a good idea of what this wonderful farmland below the uplands looked like. Let's go to the next slide. Here's a view which is east of the Grange Hall, Got back to this today. Look at the road here, and you're looking downhill and up just above this area was where the Grange Hall is today. Let's go to the next slide. And you see it here. We can see the schoolhouse, which it was torn down in the late 1920s, and the present building built. And we see the Grange Hall, so we know this is after 1905. And beyond it is the store. We think it was before 1925, actually. And this building burns, and eventually, stores move across the street. Go to the next slide. Here we see the road coming into Locke's Mills. This place is still standing. This place has just been removed and a new building built on it. This is the store building which burns in 1925, January 1st.
So that's the barn?
That
store building is the old barn now?
No, that burns in 1925.
All the way down.
Okay, let's go to the next one. Next slide, please. And this is a great view because this shows what became the Newton store. And this is before 1925, because there's the store building here. Here's the Grange Hall, 1905. And here's the noise place, and you can see the schoolhouse further up. So that's a great view of the of Bean's Corner, as it was known and still known as today. Let's go to the next slide. This is my great-grandfather, or great-grandmother. We know this is about before 1909 because he tears down the barn and builds a new barn there. He's built a new shed, you can see here. He was the leading carpenter in the building of the Grange Hall in 1905. two other people helped him, George Hastings being one of them, and one of the Bartletts was the other one. And Bob Hastings always said that it's a wonder the building stood because they had quite a crew, and the crew liked their hard cider. This wasn't a temperance building at all. They had their hard ciders. Wonder any of the buildings, any parts of the building were straight, but anyway, that building is still standing today. So.
So Stanley, that's in front of you, the Howe house?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, and your driveway?
Yeah, the driveway. And this is Fred and Agnes Pierce.
What a hat.
Okay, let's go to the next one. Here's the hall as it looked, and here's the stable behind it. And the stable eventually will be moved to Hastings, across from Hastings to Hastings Place. And I think they paid $30 for the stable building. Moved it, cut it in half, and moved it up there. And of course, in 1994, I think when Florence had her 90th birthday, they removed the building, and that was the end of it. But here it is down here at the Grange stable. You see the Grange here? We still have this lamp here in the back of this, still the remains of this lamp here. So here's an idea. It's a very modest hall. It's one of the grand buildings, but nonetheless, it's been a very important part of the community all these years. Let's go to the next slide. We see Maggie Newton's store here. This would be the store from the 1920s probably to the 1960s. Next slide. And here's the noise place as it looked probably in the 19-teens or 20s.
This
is
for sale?
Yes, it's for sale. And here we have the East Bethel Church, just up the road from the Grange Hall. And the next slide, please. And we see that's being used by Bicentennial 1976. And we see it being used for a special event during the Bicentennial of the country. Let's go to the next slide. And here we see a couple pairs of horses at Dean's Corner, the Grange Hall in the background. And so we have the school, which is up above the Grange Hall, east of the Grange Hall. We have the church, which is west of the Grange Hall. And we have a few farm buildings at Dean's Corner. This is the center of everything for some people, because remember in the 19th century, neighborhoods were very important. You didn't think of towns necessarily thought of neighborhoods, and this is what this neighborhood was like. So the next slide. Here we see probably a group of extension ladies about 1929. We know great-grandmother, this is my great-grandmother here, she dies in 1930, so we know it's before that. We see Bernice Noyes here, who was born in 1906, and we see a number of the neighborhood ladies here. I don't think too many of these people are still alive, but we know Florence Hastings is here. She just turned 100, you see, so there she is there. So, no, there she is. There she is right there. From Bronkhurst, Minnesota. There's some of the ladies at the extended service in front of the Grange Hall, obviously, was a very important time. Let's go to the next slide, please. We see the Kimball family. We see the we think this is probably Melon Kimball, and we see his father, Seelan, and his father, Charles Melon Kimball. So the Kimballs, of course, lived beyond the Hastings. Of course, then they were very well furnished part of the Grange. And of course, Charles Melon Kimball was a long time selectman in the town. So let's go to the next slide. Here we see a violent reunion during the teens. At the Grange Hall, quite an extensive family group, and you can see quite elegantly dressed and quite a prosperous group of people. So let's go to the next slide. And we see another group at the Bartlett House where Doc Bartlett lives, another group of Bartletts. But these family rooms, remember I said the Grange was very much a family organization, a community organization, and family meetings were often part of the Grange festivities. Let's go to the next slide. Here we see Willard Powell, who was a master of the Grange. He's in front of the noisy yard here. Grange is over here. And of course, Powell's, his grandfather, Porter Powell, one of the great farmers of the Bethel. Let's go to the next slide, please. And this is my father. He was a master in the 1940s as well. Let's go to the next slide. And we see a group of myself and my cousins. Here I am here, and all of my grandmother's grandchildren, except one in this photograph, this one here, joined the Grange. Remember, all but one of them, John, is a member of Alder and Grange today. So it's interesting to see all these people. We're tied in the Grange. Almost all of us get into the Grange one time or another. So it's interesting to see how many of us. You see Nancy and this George and Peter and my sister Sue and my brother Alan. So it's quite a group of people. So let's go to the next slide. And here's another one. Just also interesting. Here's my brother Sadaw. Oh, he's the only one that didn't join the Grange in the picture there. So you see how my grandmother must have influenced us all. So let's go to the next slide. Here we see an interior view of the Grange. I'm not sure who some of these people are. I'm not sure these two people. No one seems to know who these people are. I think this is Alan Stevens. This is Richard Stevens' father. And this is Clee Bartlett, who's a longtime treasurer of the Grange. Also selectman of Bethel at one time. Next slide, please. Here's another view of pouring coffee, I guess. Is Richard Stevens. He was a longtime master of the Grange. Of course, we have Dave Bartlett again, the treasurer. Next slide, please. And this is 1960, I believe it is. We have these tables set up upstairs. Oyster stew supper was always the tradition at installation. This is all offices of the Grange have all been installed here. And let's see if I can give you all the names. Here's my mother. Here's Charlie Haynes, Cynthia Hicks, Myra Foster, and we have Lillian Violet. And in back, we have Peter Haynes, George Haynes, here I am, Fred Haynes, Alvin Stevens, my grandmother Edith Howe, and Richard Stevens and Huddle Stevens, his wife. So that's the group. And a lot of people aren't alive today. I'm going to tell you a little story about the clock. This was this wonderful clock we loved for so long, many years, and I loved to hear it ticking. And as people were discussing things, or there was a motion made, and people had to think things over, I could always hear the clock ticking. And for years, we were always worried we closed the Grange. We didn't have meetings for a long time in the wintertime. And down at the hall, we had it at my house or other places. And for years, I took the Grange clock home and put it under my bed, and it was there for safekeeping. Well, one winter I decided, well, I'm not going to close the Grange. I said, I don't, no sense in my taking the clock. No one's going to bother it. And so I didn't take it. Well, we had a break-in in the Grange. And of course, the first thing they took, I guess, was the clock. And we never saw it again. I missed the clock. So I bought the nearest thing I could find with a clock like it was a battery-operated one. But it still looks like it, but isn't that clock. So it doesn't feel like it's the same clock. But anyway, that gives you an idea about that one. Let's go to the next slide, please. This is my grandmother. She, of course, came from she was a third generation Granger, and of course was very active in the Grange. She became the outstanding homemaker in 1900 by the University of Maine, and of course was a longtime secretary of the Grange, and she was later overseer. So she was one of the people that really was a bulwark of the Grange. So next slide, please. Here we see I was driving my truck, and we had a float honoring the town of Greenwood's 170th anniversary. We noted here that the our Grange is founded in Greenwood, so this is what this sign says. So, okay. And here we have a kind of a rough group here, I think. I look like I was just staggered out of the hall. And Randy looks like he's shell-shocked. And the other looks like he's cowering. And these two look like they're stunned, so I mean, we have quite a group there. So we've just been, I don't know who this little boy is, but he seemed to be the only normal one there. And I don't remember who he was, but anyway, we just had a yard sale and we had a chicken barbecue, so it tells you something about some of the things going on in the Grange Hall. So let's go to the next slide. This is a picture from 1979. This is the state master, James Shores. This is Karen Brown, who was served in the legislature. She was visiting Grange. This is from the 75th anniversary of the Grange. We celebrate, and this is Fred Jenkins, some of you remember him, long time mayor of Upton, and have several men dress up and represent each decade of the 1920s, 30s, 40s, 50s, and 60s. Well, I don't think some people didn't think that was too funny. It was certainly less than noise the master didn't think it was funny. This is his expression. All the time I was on the floor crying laughing, Leslie had this look that this made you just block with an arm. So that was what it was like. And so let's go to the next slide. Here we see Myra Fawcett playing the piano. She was a longtime secretary. After Margaret Bartlett got through, she took over. She was the pianist at Grange, too. She also was a teacher at East Bethel School. Let's go to the next slide. And here we see the, Richard Felt, famous Richard Felt, and Charlotte Cole, and I've forgotten this man's name, but he played the...
Brooks.
Brooks, yeah. What was his name? Cal Brooks. Cal Brooks, yeah. He played the Bones or something like that. He did something like that. So, and so this was the band we had for that particular occasion. Now let's go to the next one. And we see my poor father as a clock in the 1920s. He wasn't too happy about doing this, but he did. It was a good sport, and he did it. You could see why we had a good time laughing. And it was a blessing. He kept that expression all the time we were doing this. Let's go to the next one. Here we see Russel Yates as a 30s femme fatale, you see. And the next one, the 40s, George Haynes, changed his outfit. And now we have the 50s coming up. This is Alvin Stevens, the Alvin Stevens for the 50s. And the knockout was Richard Stevens for the 60s in his miniskirt. How would you keep your face not laughing about this? This is one of the funniest things we ever saw. Let's go to the next. And here's Leslie. And here is the mistake master. He didn't think it was funny at all, I don't think so. Let's go to the next slide. In 1994, we had, 15 years later, we had Leslie again. He is going to get his, I think it's going to be his 65th seal. And we had a big celebration again, and had all kinds of people all come and help us celebrate our anniversary. So this is what, this is the Connie Tubelis, the deputy, giving Leslie his 65th seal. Let's go to the next slide. Here's the state dancer at the time, Clyde Berry, addressing the group. Okay, let's go to the next slide. And here we are cutting the anniversary cake. And Connie Tubelis is doing that. Let's go to the next slide. Here's state master with Leslie and Kimball. Faye Kimball, yes. Faye Kimball was the other person, and she, well, she and Leslie joined the Grange at the same time, so they were getting both the 65th seat.
Yes, yes.
This one, this is Clyde, Clyde Berry, the state master. Okay, let's go to the next slide. Here he is, again, talking to the group. And here's Connie Tubelis. Okay, let's go to the next slide. And again, he's addressing the group. We have several pictures of him. Okay, let's go to the next slide. And here's Faye getting her 65th year seal. And there they are with the anniversary cake. So, Leslie doesn't change expression very much, does he? Let's go to the next slide. The next one, I think, was in 1999. We had the national master visit the Grange. And here's his wife here. And here's the state master and his wife here. Here's a member, I think, of Rumpel Grange here. So let's go to the next slide. And here's Mrs. Richardson here. She was the wife of the national master. And let's go to the next slide. We were very lucky because we were the first Grange in Maine that had a national office to visit us in a long time. So we were pretty, here we are, this is his national master, this is his national master's wife, this is the state master, his wife. And here we are cutting the cake for that period. So it was quite interesting. 1999, I think it was. Let's go to the next slide. Here we have an upstairs photograph of the state master and his wife, Connie Tubelis, my mother, and the national master and his wife. So we had quite a photograph there. We started photographing the upstairs screen. Let's go to the next slide. And here's the national master talking to Althea Fish, who comes from Dixfield in our hall. Let's go to the next slide. And just soon after that, we decided to move, my sister gave us the piano, my mother's piano, and for the Grange Hall, and so we had to get it down to the Grange Hall, and we got borrowed someone's snowmobile trailer, and I was nervous as the devil. I said, how are we going to get down on Cape Hill? I had the piano come off. They wrapped it a couple times with a big canvas, you can see them here, canvas harnesses, and no one seemed to worry about it. Well, my brother and someone else, I think Tom Carter, were on there riding the load, and someone was driving along, and I decided to go very slowly, because I didn't want to see the thing go down on Cape Hill, so I waited until I got down on Cape Hill. By the time I got down there, I thought we were okay, and we were, and you can see going down the road, never moved an inch, and but I was nervous about it. And so it went along. Let's go to the next slide here. And here it is being moved into the Grange Hall. So it did make it okay. And it's been a wonderful thing for the Grange Dynamo. We had several people come. We give them the offer. We have a standing offer. If somebody comes and plays the piano, they get a free supper. So it's a good time who had to play the piano and get a free supper. So. Okay, let's go to the next slide. Here we see the Hastings family out in back, out in front of the Miss Florence, and Barbara, and her two brothers here, and three of her cousins, three women cousins. So with her aunt Florence Hastings. Let's go to the next slide. We had a school reunion several times here. These built the school, of course, the Grange Hall was used by the school as an auditorium. And we had several times we had a school reunion, and here's some of the people who came to the school reunion one of the years we had it. So let's go to the next slide. And these are all school reunions. Here's Jenny, and I think this is Adele, and this is Mary Alice, and Mary Dean, and so several people in the theater there, some who grew up in the theater. Let's go to the next slide. Here's a couple people out speaking. Lynn Mason and Courtney joined the Grange a few years ago now, and Bronson, of course, now has become an honorary member of the Grange, and here I am taking her. I took Lynn out to a place where she's speaking on the Grange. I think it was over in Waterford we spoke. She spoke to another group, and so we're on the road a lot with Lynn and her dog. So let's go to the next slide. This is an interesting photograph. We see here two Carters who were active in the Grange, or very important parts of the Grange. This is Paul Carter, and this is Dick Carter here. They're the only two of their the five siblings who belong to our Grange. The rest of them never belong to any Grange. But Paul Carter left the Grange some money, which has become one of our endowment funds. So, and Dick Carter is still active. He's just turned 90, so he's still a member of the Grange. So, let's go to the next slide. Here we see another group of people who were at the school reunion, including Ann Hastings Morton and Peter, and Dot Rowland and Gloria, and I think this is one of the Smiths. Let's go to the next slide. There's another group of people, Peter and some other people, I'm not sure who all of them are, Dot Rowland's on the other side, but some of the people who went to Rupp East Bethel had some connection to the school. Let's go to the next slide. Here's another group of school reunion people. So the next slide. And here's Nancy Mercer. And this is Margaret Brown's daughter, Shirley Brown, Edie, and her husband. They live in California now. She lives in East Bethel. Let's go to the next slide. Here's Bernice Noyce, who was one of the people I remember best from the Grange. She was a teacher most of her life. And she was Leslie Noyce's wife. And she had a lot of good sense of humor, but I'm not sure Leslie had a sense of humor, but didn't show it off very much in Grange. And but Bernice was she played the piano. I still would love to see them, hear the march that she used to play in Grange when the pianist was not there, the regular pianist. She always played this march. I never heard it again, because I always remember that march she played. And she was one of those interesting people that I knew very well growing up. So let's go to the next slide. Here's Eva Bean. She was a member of the Grange one time. Here's my grandmother. And this lady visited our Grange for years. She never joined, but She was on regular at the Grange. She lived in East Bethel, but always kept a membership at the Anvil Junction down in Auburn, but she was a regular at Grange for years. Let's go to the next slide. Here's the school, and as it looked after the new school, this is the new school built in the late 1920s. This is where I started school, and it had two rooms, but by the time I got there, there was only one room being occupied, and only one being used as a school room. The other one we used for special events and special times. And the Grange was our real auditorium, though, and the Grange took a great interest in the school, and for years furnished us milk. And so we were very grateful to the Grange for furnishing us milk, which we could, was a wonderful part of our home, of our hot lunch program. The mothers in the neighborhood usually brought something hot for us to eat. So everyone took turns. The mothers took turns bringing us something for lunchtime. And then the Grange furnished us some milk. So the Grange for years, that was their contribution, one of the contributions. Let's go to the next slide. Here's another family group. I think it shows you all the people that were involved. The only people that didn't belong to Grange were Aunt Alice and Polly. Aunt Alice was from the level, but she was not a Granger, and Aunt Polly wasn't. But everyone else, except for my brother, was holding my sister, so was the Granger. Isn't that something? One of those pictures that have a lot of Grangers in it. So let's go to the next slide. There's Bob and Florence Hastings, because they were very long-time Grangers. And Bob, of course, always said that he was 5 years old when the Grange was organized out of Box Mills, because he was there with his father and mother. So he said he was like a charter member. He was there when it all happened. So we're always glad to have Bob tell us about the old days of Grange. So let's go to the next. And of course, Doc Canwell, for years has been our pianist at the Grange. She doesn't belong to our Grange, but she comes to help us out. And she is a member of Oxford Grange. Is in New York. In New York, the years taught in the East Bethel School. She was one of the first teachers, I think, taught teaching in the new school in 1929. She had my father, and she played in the service. So it's interesting to see how she survived way beyond anyone's expectations. I think she's now in her mid-90s. Let's go to the next slide. The Grange was, for years, had an agricultural exhibit at the fair. For a long time didn't do it, but the last few years it's done it again, so, and this is at primary fair. Let's go to the next slide. Another view. Next one. Another one. And just before my mother died, she received her 50th year seal, so she made it, even though she joined the Grange fairly late, she was in her 30s when she joined the Grange, but she made it to a 50-year member. This was the ceremony which honored her at that milestone. This man is now the state overseer of the Grange. This is the state lecturer, so she had some very distinguished guests at that special presentation. Let's go to the next slide. And this summer we had the 100th anniversary of the Grange. We had a tent outside, we had a special program, we had quite an event. The state master came, here he is holding up the cake that we had for the 100th anniversary, so we can all see it from the camera. Let's go to the next slide. And we had the group here, we had the tent we see, we served the most incredible, bondless meal I ever saw. You see, everything you imagine, no one went away hungry. Let's go to the next slide. Is State Master Barrow. This is Jim Lowe, the master, and this is Nancy Mercer. She must have found something quite funny. She seemed to be quite amused by something. And we got this special plaque presented to us for 100 years of Grange membership in this state Grange. Let's go to the next slide. Here's another view. Here's Steve Barrow reading the proclamation about Alder Grange. Next slide. I'm going to end with this man. This is Israel Grenville Kimball. And he was the master of Bethel Grange. And his son belonged to Bethel Grange. But when Bethel Grange closed, his son moved to Alder River, and his grandson moved to Alder River. And so that this next slide, would allow this young man, who is the son of my cousin George Haynes, to be a sixth generation Granger, isn't it something? I don't think that too many families have that many generations involved with Grange, and it's interesting to see that this young man is, he's our youngest member, he's now in his mid-20s, and but it shows that Grange has been an important part of our family life, and just an important part of the community, in East Bethel and many other communities around the state. And let's go to one final one. This is the way the part of the Grange Hall looked at the sedative activities in the summer. So for that, we will sign off and ask if any questions or any comments from the audience. So. Okay. Yes. Go ahead.
When we used to go on to Grange about that, we tried to recruit a few people once in a while, and they would always ask, is it some kind of religious overtone to it, or whatever?
Yeah, a call or something? Because one of the things that people have, some people are concerned, because it still has a secret component of it, because remember the original founders were Masons, and of course they, a lot of it's based on the Masonic, some of the Masonic principles and organization. And I think you're going to see some of the that get less and less important. I think you're going to see we seem to be moving toward being having open meetings more and more. I'm not sure how it's all going to come out, but there's a movement to eliminate more and more of the secret parts of the brain.
Yeah.
But there is but it is there's very little left now. I think the passwords and the, you know, some of the salutations, but that's about it. It's not, it's very secret anymore, and so I think it's becoming, they seem to be moving in that direction, but of course there's a great, Maine has a long tradition of being interested in ritualism. They like the ritualism of the Grange, and they were one of the big holdouts in the National Grange, that Maine wants to keep the ritual and all this sort of stuff, and so there's a lot of discussion, I guess you'd say, about how the Grange is going to change as we move into the 21st century.
Stanley, how did the ritual start?
Well, the Masons, they see, remember the...
Oh,
the,
so it went with the Masons.
They were if you go, if you belong to Grange, you belong to Masons, I guess. People tell me there's a lot of similarities.
In the 19th century,
both 19th century organizations. And there's a lot of similarities between the Grange and the Masons. So, and so that's, and of course, secret organizations were very big in that time, and fraternal organizations were very big. And they're different today, so you have to have a whole new perspective on these things. So, so we know that the Grange is evolving, and probably will be quite different in a few more years. I'm not sure how it's all going to come out, but we're all very interested to see what does happen. So,
Stanley, why do you think the first Alder Grange at Lock Mills folded? Why did it close? Why do you think it?
I don't know.
It didn't last, what, a decade? Maybe a decade?
It lasted from 1874 or 5 to 1893, about 15, let's see, what would that be, 6, 17 years, 18 years? And we're not sure. The meetings were held where Peter Haynes lives, upstairs of the hall there. And they started at all. It was interesting, they went back to the same hotel and started again, you see. It's interesting to see how they did that. But I don't know, because only...
Did they actually meet at Lock Mills, or were most of the meetings...
They held the first meeting at Lock Mills at the hotel, the organization meeting. I probably did it, the original one, too, so... But it was soon after that they started meeting people's homes and had the suppers and started raising the money for the hall.
What exists for records for the first Grange?
Not much. We have one book, and there's not much there. But we have all the records. They've all survived, all the records since 1904, so we're lucky that they're still around. And as I say, I have one up there in the cabinet, which you may want to take a look at. The day I joined the Grange, so 1957, so it was really about 47 years ago this month, so it's interesting to see how a lot. So anybody have any questions or anything else? else you'd like to know about?
I'd like to know when the school closed.
Closed in 1968.
And then you all had to go by a long distance to
Went up to
Bethel?
Went up to Bethel, yes. There was only four grades there. See, it was only sub-primary, first, second, third, and fourth, first, second, and third grades. So it was only four grades there. So it wasn't really a... Before that, they were eight grades, but it was they gradually whittled it down. And I went from third grade to fourth grade. I went to what is now the Upper Busby School. And the next year, I went to Preston Park. So I went to three different schools in three different years, you see. So it really was kind of interesting to see how it did go.
Now, how did you get to Bethel?
School bus.
They did put a bus in.
It was the high school students that had to find their own transportation because they didn't have transportation from rural areas. We had to ride with various people. I rode with a lot of people going to school. I think of all the people I rode with. One of them was Bernie Snow. Yes, he was there for a while. Ruth Hastings took us for a while. Several other people took us. And we had our own cars or to drive. We had somebody else could drive for us.
I know Barbara Hunkel moved into town.
Right.
So she could go to school.
Yes, she did. That's right. Mother moved in. Yeah.
A lot of people did it at that time.
That's right. That's right.
In Norwood too.
Yeah.
We had girls that lived with us from Waterford and
yes.
Harrison because they wanted to go to Norwood High School.
Yeah.
And they had to live or something.
Yeah.
They had to
run on buses and
they had to live all week.
Basically, in Rumford, it was the same thing. They'd come in from some of the outlying places and boards for people.
That's right.
And work their board, used to call it.
Yeah,
it happened a lot, yeah.
That was being done when I was in high school. Mm-hmm. People still did it in the late 40s. Mm-hmm. And also, they didn't even go home on the weekend during the war years because they probably
couldn't get
gas. Because they had
no gas or
hard to remember.
Yeah. Alder paid all the dues of all the members who served in the service in World War II.
Well, we walked everywhere. She didn't think anything of walking 4 or 5 miles. You know, that was.
Any other questions about the Grange or anything else you want to know? Thank you for being such a good audience.